Blackstone presents Democratic Justice, Felix Frankfurter, the Supreme Court, and the Making of the Liberal Establishment by Brad Snyder. This book is read by James Fouhey. To Shelby, Lily, and Max. To Harry and Linda Snyder. To Jack and Donna Hunt. Introduction. A Presidential Visit. At 5 p.m. on July 26, 1962, the presidential motorcade left the back entrance of the White House for the nearly 3-mile drive to Georgetown. Within minutes, President John F. Kennedy arrived at a 3-story white brick house at 3018 Dumbarton Avenue for an off-the-record meeting with Justice Felix Frankfurter. On April 5th of that year, the 79-year-old Supreme Court Justice had collapsed at his desk and fallen to the floor in his chambers. He was carried into an ambulance and rushed to George Washington University Hospital. He had suffered a stroke and, 5 days later, another stroke that, like the first one, cleared itself. Doctors diagnosed it as a cardiovascular insufficiency. New York Times columnist James Reston wrote, "His problem is not insufficiency, but oversufficiency. His difficulty is not a shortage of anything, except maybe size, too much blood and energy, too many ideas, interests, and opinions racing too fast through too small an area." Frankfurter had an oversufficiency of friends, too. After his stroke, letters and telegrams poured in from cabinet members, U.S. senators, fellow justices, dozens of former Harvard law students, law clerks, and friends from around the world, and the youngest of 3 British children he and his wife had taken in during World War II. His closest friend, former Secretary of State Dean Acheson, took charge limiting visitors and updating them on the justice's condition. The stroke had paralyzed his left arm and leg, slowed his lightning speech to about the normal human rate, but left his mind mostly intact. His doctor said it was up to him whether he lived or not, that he had to relearn how to use certain muscles and stop thinking about his work at the court. By mid-May, Frankfurter announced that on his doctor's advice, he would not return to work until the Supreme Court's next term began in October. Frankfurter's friends, Kennedy's national security advisor McGeorge Bundy and Washington Post publisher Phil Graham, believed that the bedridden justice would be forced to retire. Retirement, however, was the farthest thing from Frankfurter's mind. After his release from the hospital on July 7th, he summoned Bundy to his home with an urgent message. The president needed to address the nation with several speeches. During his hospitalization, Frankfurter had encountered numerous nurses, orderlies, attendants, and doctors, and discussed their views on the president and his policies. He believed that political and social change should start with Kennedy and his legislative agenda, and worried about what he had heard in the hospital. In a memorandum to the president, Bundy relayed Frankfurter's concerns that the hospital staff was all strongly in favor of you without knowing what you were for. Frankfurter had some advice for the president about the problem. Bundy warned the president about Frankfurter's wary attitude toward the administration, described him as a man I love, and insisted that the justice was a man who prefers to like people, and in his combination of wit, zest for politics, and sense of style, he should be a natural talking partner and friend for you. Frankfurter's wife, Marion, Bundy wrote, was a different story. She suffered from rheumatoid arthritis, and for several years had rarely left her bed by choice. She was, according to Bundy, a deeply neurotic and selfish woman, and a deep trial to all the justice's friends, but he adores her. After an in-person briefing from Bundy, Kennedy set off for Georgetown to call on Frankfurter. The president knew the neighborhood well. As a congressman and senator, he had lived in Georgetown, not far from Frankfurter's residence. On the night of his inauguration, he had stopped by the home of a mutual friend and Frankfurter's neighbor, columnist Joseph Alsop. The president was close to another member of the Georgetown set.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.